Good morning, friends. I'd like to welcome you to our study today. We are in the book of Genesis, and we are in chapter 30. And there are some things that I want us to look at today. We have seen that this chapter has all to do with the family of Jacob, and now it is dealing with the finances of Jacob. Jacob had made a work contract to work 7 years for Leah, 7 years for Rachel. That contract has come to an end, and Jacob has not had a chance to renegotiate with Laban. Laban has not come to him. Laban is probably enjoying the fact that Jacob right now is serving him, and it's costing Laban nothing. So in the midst of this contract that they're seeking to make, in verses 31 through 36, I want us to look at those verses today, and there's some things that we can learn from these verses. And then the next day that we come together, Lord willing, we will finish this chapter. But in Genesis chapter 30, and we are in verse 31, and he said, "What shall I give thee?" And Jacob said, "Thou shalt not give me anything. If thou wilt do this thing for me, I will again feed and keep thy flock. I will pasture all the flock today, removing from thence all the speckled and spotted cattle, and all the brown cattle among the sheep, among the sheep, and the spotted and speckled among the goats, and of such shall be my hire. So shall my righteousness answer for me in time to come, when it shall come for my hire before thy face. Everyone that is not speckled and spotted among the goats, brown among the sheep, that shall be counted stolen with me." And Laban said, "Behold, I would it might be according to thy word." And he removed that day the he-goats that were ring-staked and spotted, and all the she-goats that were speckled and spotted, and every one that had some white in it, and all the brown among the sheep, and gave them into the hands of his sons. And he set 3 days' journey betwixt himself and Jacob, and Jacob fed the rest of Laban's flocks. So as we come into these verses, we see the negotiation contract that they make for the labor of Jacob. Of course, Jacob has a large family. He wants to make sure that his family is taken care of. Laban should desire to see that the family is taken care of as well, because Jacob's family here would be Laban's grandchildren. And as we come into these verses, Jacob comes up with a plan, and that plan calls for him to receive the odd-colored animals that were born in the future for himself. Now, this is something that was very uncommon. Notice you'll see his proposal in verse 32. He says, "I will pass through all thy flock today, removing from thence all the speckled and spotted cattle, and all the brown cattle among the sheep, and the spotted and speckled among the goats, and of such shall be my hire." This was a very surprising proposal by Jacob. For in these countries, like that what he's living in right now, the animals with markings, which Jacob said would be his, were very few in number. And Jacob knew Laban. He had lived with Laban for 14 years. He knew that Laban was a man of greed, and that Laban would be quick to accept such a contract. But Jacob also knew that he planned to cheat Laban out of the plain colored animals by producing abnormally marked animals. So the contract looked liberal for Laban, but Jacob's scheming discredits his apparent generosity. Jacob is not being near as generous here as Laban at this point would be making him out to be. And then in verse 4, it says, Laban said, "Behold, I would it might be according to your word." Jacob says, "That sounds wonderful for me. Let's do exactly what it is that you say you want to do." Jacob here did not realize that he was bargaining with a man who could be just as beguiling and deceitful and crafty as Laban could be himself. And it's interesting as you watch these two in this passage, because in reality, Jacob and Laban here are two of a kind. Both were just as shrewd as the devil, and both could drive home a very hard bargain with the unsuspecting. And that's exactly what's taking place in these verses. And Jacob and Laban were the kind of guys, if you were doing business with them, man, you wanted to keep both hands on your wallet. Because both of them here violating this new contract, and they had obvious intention of doing that right from the very beginning. They had things in their minds that they were keeping to themselves about how it was a way that this contract would benefit them. And then notice in verses 35 and 36. It says, and he removed that day, that is Laban, removed that day the he-goats that were ring-staked and spotted, and all the she-goats that were speckled and spotted, and everyone that had some white in it, and all the brown among the sheep, and gave them into the hands of his sons. Now go with this. And he set 3 days' journey betwixt himself and Jacob, and Jacob fed the rest of Laban's flocks. So Laban said, okay, that's the deal. That's the contract. That's what you'll get. And then he runs out and he separates all of those animals from his flock. And then he gives them to his other sons. And he sends them away 3 days' journey from away from where Jacob is. So here's what's happening in verses 35 and 36. Jacob had stated that day he would remove the livestock or the animals from the livestock, the animals with the abnormal markings. But Laban beat Jacob to the punch. Laban beat Jacob to it. And Laban stole part of Jacob's salary here that would prevent Jacob from having the abnormally marked ones because he had stolen them and moved them away. And Laban put 3 days' journey between where Jacob was and Jacob to keep away these animals from him, to keep from Jacob that which he agreed to allow it to be Jacob's. And some people might even question, why would Jacob even tolerate Laban's actions here? I mean, Jacob had been around the cattle all along. He knew the cattle. He knew how many speckled and spotted there were. Why is it that Jacob tolerated Laban's actions? And I believe it was because of the fact that Jacob was scheming all along, and he felt that his scheming would more than compensate for any loss that Laban was going to bring into the life of Jacob. Friend, let me encourage you today as we close this study out to be honest in your dealings with people. The employer that you work for, make sure that you do not steal from them. And when I steal from them, I'm just not talking about taking a hammer or taking something that belongs to them. I'm talking about taking a day's pay and not giving an honest day's work in return. Be honest to your employer. Be honest to the people that you deal with. Do not seek to deal in deceit and in guile and in treachery. I know some people, sadly, even some who would call themselves Christians, who when they're buying things, they're very cheap, and oh, this isn't worth anything, and this is wrong, and that's wrong. But yet when they sell, they want top dollar for absolutely everything that they have. Friends, we as a people of God must be known as a people that are honest. We must say what we mean, and we must mean what we say. And we must not allow our attitudes, we must not allow our emotions to get in the way of what we're saying. But we must be very careful that what we are speaking is the truth, and that we are speaking it in a way that honors and glorifies the Lord Jesus Christ, that we are speaking it from his heart and from his mindset. There was a day when it was a common adage or a common saying of the day that a man's word is his bond. And friends, that ought to be the way it is with the people of God. And I want to encourage you to be honest in your dealings with people. That is one of the marks of integrity that will either take you a long ways as a Christian in your testimony for Jesus Christ, or a lack thereof will completely destroy your testimony for Jesus Christ. There is no middle ground. We need to understand it's more than just us and what we want that's on the line. It is the reputation of the Lord Jesus Christ in this world that we live in. And we must be careful, friends, that we represent him well. Have a great day.